I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house of the living God.
This is the day that we do rejoice about the creation.
This is our Sabbath, when we rejoice in the resurrection of Jesus the Christ.
We give thanks that once more God has brought us together, that we might refresh one another. Peace to all who live here. Peace to stay in every day. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please remain standing. Join me in the hymn, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. Page 64 in your hymn. Thanksgiving.
Remember, we got to say thank you here. Boy, this, someone typed this out and made it a nice. Thank you. I would like to thank everyone for the prayers, cards, and phone calls during the illness and passing of Annabelle, my sister-in-law. And that comes from J.C. Nibelich. Very good. And we have Deb Burnett. And thank you. I just don't know how to do it. Please, she has to pray for her nephew, Brock. Support counseling to sink in while trying to rehab. Very good. And we'll keep those in our prayers in joyful praises. And also, inside your bulletin, there's a whole list of people with like various health concerns and dealing with various losses and just things that are on their mind. I ask that you keep those folks in your mind in prayers as well. And I want to find out what's going on here. Stuff has to be happening. Yes? A mission team left this morning for Kentucky. Pray for them. Did they take a rowboat? Because going down to Kentucky, you might need it with all this rain. We'll keep them in our prayers. I know Joy, I know Larry in our congregation. His wife's been ill, and she's here. And a lot of times I've been here, she hasn't, but she is here in the back. That's a joy that I see just as a visitor from time to time. Anything else? Anything else going on? Yes, you, Miss Black Belt.
Yeah, they left today.
Kids? Okay, so is that a joy that the kids are not here? Or a concern for their safety? Very good. I just want to make sure. It's like a yin and a yang. A little bit of both. Pray for the children and the youth that are out away at camp. You know, pray that they receive Christ and as you learn more about Him in fellowship with other children and guides and counselors along the way. And way in the back, yes.
I have a joy for the co-worker of Doug Walker's last week with the baby. She was improved greatly. She was able to come off the ice bed, and she's expected to go home sometime this week.
Sweet. Yes, that is a true joy right there. That is awesome. Anything else? Well, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come here as your children. We come here looking for something. We know what it is. We're looking for your love to fill our lives. We're broken. We're wanting to be made whole again. We are empty, and we need your love to fill that empty void that nothing else in the world can fill. And while we're here, we want to pray for this holy place, even United Methodist Church. Pray that your love and your peace and your joy fills the sanctuary, and it spills out to the world around us. And we, as we go out as a community, and we also pray for our country. We pray for our leaders. It doesn't matter if our leaders are Republican or Democrat or liberal or conservative. We pray that all the leaders universally have your peace and your joy and your wisdom. We pray that you influence their lives, their choices, and their decisions. And we also pray for armed services. We know this is a crazy world filled with a lot of darkness. We pray for their safety as they are in harm's way, protecting us from evil forces. And we're also praying for their families, for the sacrifices that they're doing. And we pray that you protect them and hold them dear as their loved ones are fighting for us. And in the light of this moment, let us lift up our prayers and our concerns and our joys that we have in our hearts. All this we ask, when Jesus taught us to pray, when he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, glory forever.
My guest, 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 my gu Okay. I always get nervous talking in these things anyway. All right. So let me tell you, this was a really hard lesson kind of to make, because it's one of those where you have to think about what ages you're having. I'm glad I made it for all age groups, because I wasn't quite sure. But the one thing that always came up while I was looking up this Matthew 28:16-20 was our mission statement. Making disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. That came up time after time after time. And I was like, wow, how weird is this? Pastor Kathy would be so proud that I'm like really noticing it. So then I was thinking, how am I going to make this for kids? And I was looking up on the internet because, hey, that's our generation. We all do the internet, we Google everything. Could not find anything I liked. And oh my, I remembered. I bought JD years ago, and I should have brought it, but I forgot because I'm a mom and I forget things to bring because I had to remember these two. And I didn't want to forget them because they had to light the candles today. And thankfully today, there was no fighting involved. So, anyway, but he has a children's Bible that is devotions. So I thought, you know what, I can see if this scripture is in the devotion. And it was. And it's for kids. And so I sort of went off of that. And nowadays, most of you kids, I bet, have either an iPod or cell phones. I know JD does because he's in sports now. Computers. You get on the computer and you Google. Some of you, not my kids, I know, but some kids have Facebook. I know adults have Facebook, and so people are totally connected today by the technology. But back in the good old days, in the ancient days when Jesus came around, I don't think we had technology like that, did we? No, we did not. So how did they communicate? And wait till you guys hear this. Do you know how they communicated? They had to walk. They had to walk. They didn't even have cars back then. Or airplanes. Yeah, they had to walk. That would be really rough on us. They had to walk or take horses, and they had to visit people. And Jesus started with 12 buddies, 12 guys. 12 guys, they said, hey, come on, let's go spread the word. And they would walk all the way around the world, and they would talk to people about the good word. And by boat, by foot, by horses, because like I said, they had no cars, no airplanes. And they would talk to people in temples or at homes, it just depends. And those people would then tell other people about Jesus. So it's ironic how things got known without technology, maybe not as fast, but people learned about Jesus without technology. So now when I give you guys your goal, is let's see if there's how you guys can go face to face with nothing that operates on a battery. Tell people about Jesus and the good word, and how we can spread the word about Christ, and maybe get more people even to come to church, because it'd be great to see more kids. I love the fact that we have new family church. It's great, especially since I've stepped up. I love seeing kids I know. But it's been done for thousands of years to spread the good word. So that's the message today. I always get nervous. Sorry about that. So let's pray real quick. Dear Heavenly Father, I just hope your word hits these kids well, to spread the good word about them. I know it's hard to be a child and talk about Jesus, but we just pray that they do, and that other kids hear the good word. Amen. And then you guys can go back to your seat to go learn, and let's you guys to hear the scripture.
Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, your pardon, Lord. And where there's doubt, true faith in you. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there's despair in life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light. And where there's sadness, ever joy. Oh, Master, grant that I may never seek so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned, in giving of ourselves that we receive, and in dying that we're born to eternal life, and in dying that we're born to eternal.
All that you have and all that you are is a gift from God. Offer then your gift in expressions of gratitude to the life-giving God of all. The ushers, please come forward. So stand and join me in the prayer of dedication. We dedicate
our lives and all that we have to the work of life, of love, of peace. Receive our gifts, bless us, and lead us in wisdom and courage.
Amen. This morning we have an assignment. He's going to get the conference report.
Well, the 7th Annual Conference of the Indian American Methodist Church took place in Indianapolis from May 28th to May 30th. The convention center in downtown Indianapolis is a beautiful place to hold an event with your people, and I was glad to represent our church. This year's conference theme was Share Your Story. Tell your children of it, and let your children tell their children and their children to another generation. We all have a personal story of how Jesus Christ came into our lives and influenced us, and each of us has a story of faith different from anyone else. We all have different experiences with Christ to share. The point being is to tell your story so that you may make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. It truly is a wonderful experience, and I'll try to share with you. I've said before, everyone should attend the annual conference just to understand what it's all about. Those of you who have gone in the past know what I mean. Next year, the conference will be from June 9th to June 11th, again in Indianapolis. Now, anyone can attend, and there's no registration charge. However, nearly all the workshops and have a cost associated with them. According to John Wesley, Christian conferencing is one means of grace. Others that he names include prayer, searching the scriptures, and receiving the Lord's Supper. There are 10 Bible-based conference guidelines set forth, which include, 1, respect others as Jesus would have done when he was here on earth. And that is based from Romans 12, chapter 10th verse. Pray for others as well as yourself, especially those of whom you disagree. That comes from 1 Timothy, 2nd chapter, 1st verse. Listen to others before thinking about what you want to say in response. Comes from Proverbs 18th chapter, 13th verse. Understand what others are saying so clearly that you accurately state their view. come from Proverbs 2nd chapter 1 through 6 verse. Share your own point of view with grace and humility, as well as honesty and candor. It comes from Ephesians 4th chapter 15th verse. Focus your comments on the issues being discussed, not on persons expressing them. It comes from Philippians 2nd chapter 3rd and 4th verses. Commit yourself to the unity of the Spirit, seeking consensus wherever. Comes from Galatians 6th chapter 9th verse. Acknowledge that you may be wrong, even when you think you are right. Comes from Proverbs chapter 15, 33rd verse. Allow the fruit of the Spirit to permeate your way of interacting with others. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Comes from Galatians 5th chapter 22nd and 23rd verses. Well, this is quoted from a bulletin from the Christian Conferencing Task Force. Well, we elected to the upcoming general and jurisdictional conferences delegates, and we had a book to go through that tells you each page has a person on it that's willing to serve. So one thing we had to sort through and vote on, everybody that votes gets a card. These elected representatives, or lay persons elected their representatives, and the clergy elected theirs. And these representatives at a two-week conference work on areas crucial to the United Methodist Church's mission and work on issues emerging from those areas. Basically, they will be making policies of the church. In the plenary sessions, we heard reports and voted to accept or reject on things such as church development, leadership development and call to fruitfulness, pension and insurance, rules and structure, Africa University conference nominating, general conference petitions, which includes societal social issues, board of trustees, 75 years of UNCOR, and of course finance and administration. No one can get all the details on the internet concerning those reports. And a few interesting items though, which included the kickoff of a financial drive for a new auditorium building at Epworth Forest. And this was not a budgetary item, it's strictly for donations. The present building is very old and needs replacement. Also, there were 9 congregations in Indiana that have been discontinued this last year, and the buildings are for sale by the conference. The United Methodist Church is growing worldwide, but that's not the case in the United States. One of the presenters had a quip that I'd like to share with you. It goes something like this, that over the years, we've sent a lot of money and missionaries overseas to help establish churches and believers. Maybe we need to have church people from underdeveloped countries come to the U.S. and give us their assistance. They seem to be more successful than we are. Well, it's something to think about. Also, the biggest portion of the conference budget goes to mission. In fact, it is 47 cents of the dollar. Now, doesn't that sound familiar? United Methodists are continually trying to reach out and help where help is needed. The worship experience along with the music was spectacular. For some parts, there was an orchestra and traditional hymns. For other parts, there was a dynamic praise band. The music was led by Francis D. Wyatt, contemporary worship and arts leader at St. Luke's United Methodist Church in Indianapolis. Now, I enjoy music, but I'm not a musician by any stretch of the imagination. The Word of God set to music, be it traditional or contemporary, is to me inspiring. There was a trade show consisting of many vendors. Cokesbury had many books for sale and other items needed by clergy and lay people. The universities affiliated with Methodists were represented, and there were booths with causes like clean water in Africa, human trafficking, insurance vendors, Henderson Settlement, Redbird Mission, Asher Home, Lebanon's Children Home, UNCOR, the Blackboard with Bob Kuhlman and Valparaiso, and many more. The featured speakers this year was our own Bishop Mike Coyner, who led the opening and closing worship services. And by the way, Bishop Coyner plans to retire August 31st, 2016. Bishop Cynthia Fierro Harvey of the Louisiana Conference, who preached during the orientation service. Dr. Everett Carver McGriff, retired elder of the Indiana Conference, who presided over the memorial service. George Howard, Deputy General Secretary of the General Board of Global Ministries, was the conference's featured teacher as well as speaker for the missions luncheon. And Paula and Ed Kasich, members of Epworth United Methodist Church in Indianapolis, and parents of Abdul Rahman or Peter Kasich, spoke at the annual prayer breakfast. I attended the annual prayer breakfast this year for the first time. The room was large and the people were many, but you could have heard a pin drop when Paula and Ed Kasich spoke. Peter Kasich was a young man beheaded by ISIS, and we all were kept abreast of what was happening via world news on our own television sets in our homes, as well as apparent statements to the press. Peter was there for humanitarian reasons and was captured. The Kasichs put their trust in God and spoke of their son's belief in Jesus Christ in Christian ways. I came away from hearing them speak thinking, without such a strong belief in Jesus Christ, how could parents possibly survive such a horrible ordeal? I think many of us might have been destroyed by something like this. Yet the Kasichs had a Christian view of what their son Peter was trying to do and show the world their Christian reaction to such a tragedy. He was really a tremendous witness. So next year, I invite all of you to attend. I don't want to keep this experience to myself. Anyone can attend, but our church has only one late voting delegate. It doesn't cost to register as a guest, but you can attend all the sessions. Sponsored meals have a cost, and most of the workshops have a cost. Radical hospitality is practiced by friendly ushers, information desks, and golf carts to help persons with difficulties move from place to place. An experience that will stretch your horizon, and it's too close to home not to take advantage of the opportunity. And I truly believe it will help build your faith story. Thank you.
Matthew 28:16-20. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountains where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." Now we welcome Larry Burks.
Right here. Can you stand up real quick for me, please? Hey, come on up here. Please, folks, give our hand for coming up here. This is atypical. We don't normally do this here in church. Stand right there. What is your name?
Stephanie.
Nice to meet you, Stephanie. And we never really officially met or talked or anything like that, so you have no idea what's going on. And I want to say, I loved you. You had a very raw, pure moment up here. It was before, no, not the nerves. It was you spoke to me and anyone here who's ever had a child. You were struggling with the microphone and trying to figure out how it works. And your son wants to jump to the rescue and help you out. I do that. And if anyone here said, "Oh, I've never done that," you're lying. We all had that moment, right? And that was pure, and that was honest, and that's what church is all about. You see? It's just like... I'm not going to mess with you. Black belt? Guy to guy here? Or you stay there. Your sister has a black belt? Don't mess with her. Serious. I heard what went down last week with the fire up here. That was something. It's on the street. It was in the paper and everything. If you can stand right over here, I want to switch spots with you. It was Stephanie, right? Come a little bit closer here. Do you do anything outside the house? Do you work outside the house? No. So you're at home with them. That's combat duty. I salute you. That's the toughest job in the world. You used to substitute. Well, that's real combat duty, substitute teaching. Well, what used to you taught? So, gave it 12, so you know teaching things and whatnot. Okay, this is a teaching tool right here. It's a pair of scissors. Phonics is fun. Now, remember, the blades are pointy, blades are sharp. The sharp stuff's on the inside, right? When you turn it inside out, the sharp's on the outside. Don't do that, because that's dangerous. Keep the sharp side on the inside, okay? Oh, hold on, that's Stephanie. And the second thing we're going to use is the deadly squishy piece of string. Okay, now why don't you take a look at this rope? Hold on to that rope. I'll take the scissors for a moment. Hold on, because you're strong. Strong and cool. That's right. It's a piece of clothesline, made to be strong, hold heavy, wet laundry. The Amish would kill for this stuff, I'm telling you. Let's show them how sharp the scissors are. If you could, cut off this end, if you could, please. Ooh, that's sharp. Mm-hmm. Open the collection plate. You might come wonder. You can put it in your pocket, zoom in here. That's good, that's good. Take it home. We plant it in the yard. See what happens. Cut off that end, if you could, please. Ooh, that's sharp. Well, look, Stephanie. It's a piece of rope with no ends. It's a bad joke. The ends are in your pocket. You can laugh at any time if you want. It's okay. You're a church. See, Jesus laughs. We can laugh. So some people think Jesus was always stoic. No. Just think about it. Jesus is on a campfire with the apostles. You know something had to go down from time to time. And there was a lot of snickering and giggling and stuff like that. Because after all, I came here. Here, give a stick right there in that loop. He came here to experience every human emotion. And laughter is part of that. Now, you've got the swing in two pieces. I, Larry, your goofy, silly preaching guy today, I'm going to take the two pieces of string and I'll tie them back together again. Kind of like a government job. Yeah, cool stimulus dollars, right? Now check this out. This is a very special knot. You don't see knots like this every day. Check that out there, crowdy kid. All right. See, they call this knot a slip knot because the very nature of this knot is designed to slip. Here, Stephanie, hold on to this end if you could, please. Now hold on over here. Hold on tight. See, if you don't like the location of the knot, take the knot, then you slip it up. Like that. If you want to take the knot, you slip it down. Like that. If you wish that to me, you take the knot, slip it right off, and start all over again. I give that to you. All right. Put it in your pocket. Protect that knot. Your girl says, Stephanie, where's the knot? Don't lie. You're in church. That's not good. See, not in your pocket. You're confused. No, it's not in your pocket. See, I confused you, too. See, where's the knot? Not my pocket. See, you're confused and you can get away. Here, give a little slip right there. But tonight, though, when you go home, you get ready for bed, you put your pajamas on, your PJs, and take that knot out of your pocket and put it under your pillow. You know what you'll find tomorrow morning? The piece of string with a knot in it, that's right, yeah. And no cash for me, lady, I'm not the tooth fairy. I got your dollar. Yeah. And you don't need people on your like that. No. Here, I'll take a shiny sharp object. I'll set this down right here. Now, this is a very special knot called the knot of the invisible wind. Take a deep breath and blow. Ooh, it blew. See the fuzzy end of the knot? Grab one of them. Just grab one of them. Hold on tight. And as you hold on tight, you go, girl. You're on bad man pajama. I'm not messing with you. Did you start the other knot? You didn't lose it, did you? Sweet. One, two. Now, imagine set. Did you do fun, crafty, Martha Stewart type things? Not license plates, but pretty things. You can make a pair of earrings. But be careful, though. The jealous ladies that don't have a set might call you a knockhead. You're not being nice. Put it in your pocket, save it for later. But check this out. You are the eyes and ears of this congregation. Did I cut on top? Yes, I did. Did I cut on the bottom? Yes, I did. I have three pieces of string, all the same length. Uno, dos, three. I can tie numbers next to it. Deep breath low. That's good. Now, the piece of string is now tiny. Oh, look at that. One is a little bit longer, and pop, very nice. We have a piece of string there, Miss Stephanie. Small, medium, large, just like going to McDonald's. There's a small, there's a medium, there's a long one, just like that. Now, let's go back where we came from. Let's hold all the ends in half so we can make all the ends meet, which is tough to do in this economy, but we'll do our best here today. That'll be good. And back around, is it good? Good, all right. Take a deep breath. Blow. A little too eager, but that's okay. Sit down. You have a pop tart for breakfast? Good, back at you. It's okay. Oh, that's okay. Now, they did the work. Good, check it out. They call ropes a bend, flex, and twist. Now there's one piece of string. There is two. There's three all the same length. But Miss Stephanie, no sooner we get started, here we are, where we began, with a piece of string that is tiny. I give that to you. When it is longer, I give it to you. And the longer to the wall, I give it to you. Please, friends, give Miss Stephanie a round of applause. Thank you, Miss Stephanie. Thank you for helping me. You thought speaking into a microphone was tough. Woo! But I appreciate you coming up here and being part of this. You see, what I did here was a silly, goofy trick. I used scientific principles, principles of psychology, in this direction to make the rope appear to cut and be put back together again, and to change sizes. That's just a trick. That's all it is, an illusion. Let me tell you about someone who doesn't do tricks. He does miracles. Jesus Christ. He can take the broken pieces of our lives, and not through illusion or sleight of hand, he can bring them back together again and heal us. Jesus Christ can transform us. I use sleight of hand to make the ropes look small and long and small again. But Jesus Christ, he transforms us into a new creation from the inside out, which is awesome. Now, the reason I did this, I wanted you folks to see how I relate Christ to people. In my ministry, when I travel around, I get to know people, we laugh, I might do something silly, goofy like that, and then I share the message of Christ with people. The scripture reading we read was from the book of Matthew, and it tells us that we need to make disciples of everyone that we meet. They call this the Great Commission. See, this is like front porch information that Christ is giving us. You see, parents know exactly what I'm talking about. If you have a message for your child, they're about to leave, go off on a date, go off to college, maybe they're already married with children, they're going home, why don't you give them some of the most important information? At the last moment, before you leave, before they leave, I should say, you're trying to impart all that last-minute information. These are some of the most important things I've got to tell you. Please listen to me. See, Jesus told this, the verse, to the disciples before he ascended into heaven, where we had to wait for his second coming. See, he said he wanted the apostles to know what they had to do, and they had to spread the good news. Jesus told the apostles, you got to spread the good news. Jesus is telling us, we as brothers and sisters in Christ, we have to spread the good news. Now please, please understand what I mean by good news. Unfortunately, our language in the modern world is very ambiguous. We take, we have one word that has a lot of different meanings. But back in the ancient world, they were talking about, not only did they have the public with their feet wearing sandals on dirt roads that weren't paved, they had very specific news, very specific words for the different messages. And that's why when we go back to the Greek, we have to look at the Greek word, because we have an ambiguous translation that can mean lots of different things. But if you go back to the root Greek word, that tells us specifically what they meant. Good news. That's the gospel. We look at good news like, hey, I got a new job. Hey, that's good news. Hey, I got an A in a test. That's good news. Good news. Or I made the team. That's good news. See, good news has different contexts for us today. It's really almost trivial to what it meant in the ancient world. Back in the ancient world, good news was reserved only for maybe the announcement of a birth of a king, or maybe the announcement of a victorious battle, or maybe the inauguration of a new emperor. Now, in retrospect, we have the advantage of time. We can look back and we can see how Jesus was all of that. You know, birth of a new king, announcement of a victorious battle over sin and death, and the announcement of a new empire. He's up in heaven with God, the Creator, the Father. But if you start to go back into context, back in the day, back in the ancient time, there was a cognitive disconnect. And they weren't fully understanding or appreciating the victory of Christ. Because they look at Jesus, he died on a very shameful Roman cross. And they had a hard time seeing how can victory come from death. And it took time. Now, this message was given to the apostles. Spread the good news. And did the apostles hide away and do nothing? Some people think they did, but they didn't. If you research it and you notice, the apostles did what they were told. They said, wait until you're visited by the Holy Spirit. It's not Charles Dickens thing, waiting for the three ghosts to come at night. No, no, no. Jesus said, the Holy Spirit will come to you. And basically, you'll know when it happens. And what happened? The day of Pentecost, right? The Holy Spirit came, kicked them out the door into the world, and to spread the good news, and to share the message of Christ in a manner that is understandable to the people that were in Jerusalem that day. We don't know fully exactly what happened, but regardless of where you came from in the ancient world, you understood the message. And as time passed, these early churches were formed by the apostles, spreading the message of Jesus Christ. These apostles went to these areas, they started these churches, except one, a church in Rome. And when you read Romans, Paul's letters of Romans, he's writing to a church that was not founded by any of the apostles. See, it wasn't formed by Paul. Paul formed a lot of churches. It was started organically from a spark that came from one of those tongues of fire on the day of Pentecost. You see, theologians and biblical scholars, they've concluded that the Church of Rome was most likely started by either a visitor or visitors to Jerusalem that day that experienced what had happened on the day of Pentecost. They took that message back to Rome, and they started the most influential churches comprised both of Jews and Gentiles. Because don't forget, back then, the Jews thought they had a cornerstone on it. There was a separation between these two cultures. The Roman church was Jewish and Gentile. And what's wild is, there was a time when the Jews were kicked out of Rome during Emperor Claudius. And what was left were the Gentiles. See, Claudius said, well, let's get rid of these Christian Jews. Claudius didn't realize there were Roman citizens, there were Gentiles that were following Christ. And the Gentiles kept the Roman church going while the Jews were gone. And it wasn't until his son Nero came in that he allowed the Jewish Christians to come back in. It's an amazing, amazing story. It truly is. But Paul, in the history of the Roman church, he was the only apostle to visit Rome. Now, Paul wasn't an apostle, as we think of the apostles, hanging out with Jesus for 3 years, going to the different places. Paul is what they call an apostle out of time. He had a one-on-one experience with Christ in the road to Damascus. And you can read about it in the book of Acts. It's remarkable. If you watch that TV series, A.D., I believe it's called. I keep calling it Acts because basically it's the book of Acts. Anybody watch A.D.? Those who didn't raise your hand, it's on Sunday evenings. It's awesome. It's awesome. It's a biblical account of what happened. And not only is it a biblical account, they filled in things that are not in the Bible, but yet are historically accurate. There's some embellishing because of time restrictions. Like the one that comes to mind is Thomas, when Jesus came back, and Thomas doubted, the apostles, you're crazy, he didn't come back, I gotta see him. Well, I think 3 days had passed before Jesus came back again. Well, they kind of embellished it like it happened one afternoon. But the essence of the story and the meaning of the story is preserved really, really well. And I highly recommend watch it. It becomes a DVD to get it. But Paul, he had the experience and became one of the apostles, the apostle out of time. And Paul was the only one to ever visit Rome. As a matter of fact, it wasn't a missionary trip to Rome. He wrote the book of Romans as a letter. And he was probably in the city of Corinth at the time, the Corinthian church. He was in another city, right in Rome. And he wanted to introduce himself to the Church of Rome, introduce his theological position, and announce that he always wanted to visit Rome. He heard great things about the church in Rome. But because of that, that's why he never, ever visited Rome. It wasn't like Paul's third missionary journey, well into his missionary career, that he decided to visit Rome. And it was a layover. He's going to stop over for a few days, check them out, say hi, as he's planning on heading over to Spain. Because Spain was at the edge of the civilized world at that time, as he known it. It was just outside the Roman influence. And he wanted to preach the word. He felt a calling, an urgency to share the message, not with other believers, but share the message with people who had never, ever heard. But God had different plans for Paul. He made him stop and stay in Rome for quite some time. See, Paul was the apostle for the Jews and the Gentiles. Paul was both country and Western. And when you start to study him, it's amazing. It's amazing how it all comes together. But the original context of the Great Commission was a specific message for a specific audience for a very specific reason. Whenever you read the scripture, you need to know that and appreciate that. Because when we start to study God's word, we have to understand the original context. And from there, we can find the meaning for all time, the meaning for us today. You see, unless the Holy Spirit, I'm not saying the Great Commission is not saying this, but unless the Holy Spirit is calling you in a specific direction, no one is telling you that you must travel off to some far land as a missionary. And I heard the report from the conference, and he's absolutely right. The Christian church is on fire throughout the world, not in America. I was at a conference a couple months ago in Louisville, Kentucky. And I was talking to some other missionaries, foreign missionaries. It was awesome. And they're training to come to America. And there's statistics saying that there are more foreign missionaries that are looking at America as the new ground that needs to hear the message of Christ. Goodness, we're busy sending our own folks off to faraway lands while the fires at home are dying away. Unfortunately, the church outside sees that foreign missionaries are coming to America to help spread the word, to help foster things back up. He's right. The church is having problems in America. But we can't lose his faith. We have to understand and appreciate these missionaries that are coming up. They're coming to us. And we got to remember, charity begins at home, but we don't keep it there. We spread it to far-off lands. But don't spread it out to far-off lands at the expense of the church here at home. And the Great Commission, it's not telling anyone specifically that you must invite someone to church. Too often, that passage uses guilt. They use that and say, you must invite someone to church or increase our numbers and have a bigger potluck lunch. No, no, no. That's not what the Great Commission is telling you. No. I'm not saying it's a bad thing. That's a great thing. But no, that's not what it's saying. And no one is telling you specifically that you must stand in a busy street sharing the gospel, the good news of Christ, in an open-air ministry format. No. And see, what's really neat about the Great Commission is prior to it, the message Christ told the apostles was, go out to the Jewish communities. Spread the word about my ministry. Spread the word about me. Spread the word about the Father to all these Jewish communities. The Great Commission is a game changer. Jesus is now saying, and he's instructing the apostles, he can instruct and share his message with everyone, both Jews and Gentiles, go out into the world. That is an all-time message. As Christians are to share Christ with everyone. We are to share Christ with everyone, not just people like us. But we have to share Christ with everyone. And then let Christ be seen in our lives, in the manner that is best suited to our gifts and talents and our abilities. You might share Christ through a hobby. I did some silly, goofy tricks here. It was a boyhood hobby. I found it as a vehicle to get to know people. And I could share the message of Christ that way. Yours might be painting. Yours might be singing. You might find a way, something that you do, that you're good at. And you let Christ shine through that. It might be through the way you conduct yourself at work or at school or out in the community. It might be even something as simple as praying before you eat in public. Oh, whoa, it's easy to pray at the dinner table, right? Well, I'm talking about Mickey D's, right? Sitting around the table around McDonald's. I'm not saying take a glass or, okay, everybody, time to pray. Don't make a spectacle of it, because you're making a spectacle of a whole relationship with Christ. Something simple, just bowing your head if you're by yourself. It's a spark that is noticed. A family, just for a moment. Hold hands for a second. Just to yourselves, just say, thank you, Christ, for this meal, and please bless it for us. Little simple sparks. That's what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to give these sparks. A hymn that I love It's our camp song, quite a bit, sung on the campfire called Pass It On. The words are, it only takes a spark to get the fire going. And soon, all those around can warm up by its glowing. That's how it ends with God's love. Once you've experienced it, you spread His love to everyone. You want to pass it on. You see, Jesus is not a religion. He is our Savior. We're obligated to let Christ be known in this dark world. Our job is very simple. All we have to do is provide that spark and let God do the rest. This is my message for this Sunday. Thanks. Actions and reactions this week, and let God do the rest. Amen.